This is lesson 2.7. In this lesson, we will be looking at linear equations without a constant term, so of the form y equals mx. If you've not participated in lesson 3.6 or do not know about slope, I would encourage you to go back and watch that lesson first, since an understanding of that material is necessary for this lesson. So in this lesson, we're going to be focusing on proportional relationships and making that connection that the k value in a proportional relationship, y equals kx, is the same as the slope in y equals mx, and then looking at graphing those equations using slope. We're continuing our learning about how mathematics is used to represent things in the real world, and then particularly focusing on proportional relationships. So here we have a situation where the students in Meg's class are building a fence around the class garden, and they use different lengths of fencing to determine the cost of 50 feet of fencing. So we have three options here, where we have 6 feet is $30, 15 feet is $75, and 24 feet is $120. What is the constant of proportionality? Now that sort of applies that it is a direct variation. So when I divide each of these ordered pairs, and they are ordered pairs because I could group them as x, y, then I should get the same value. And I group them as x being the feet and y being the money because the independent variable is typically your x, and the x in this problem is how many feet of fence you buy. You dictate how much fence you need to buy, and then that's going to dictate the cost. So the cost is dependent upon the length of fence that you purchase. So if I do 30 divided by 6, because again, remember the constant of proportionality is the y over the x equals the k, then I get $5 per foot. If I do 75 divided by 5, I get $5 per foot. And if I do 120 divided by 24, I also get $5 per foot. So that further reinforces that this is a proportional relationship. So my direct variation is 5, or 5 over 1. So that goes with the image of the fences. The second question says, what is the slope of the line graphed? So if I look at my graph here, you can see that I have a rise, if I look, use these two points here, I got a rise of 130 and a run of 26. So I have rise over run. And if I divide those, I get 5. So the slope of that line is 5. So what do you notice about those two values? They're the same. And if you think about it, that makes sense, because if you look at this image and the table that you can make from it, it is a direct variation, and a direct variation means that its graph should start at the origin, just like my line does, and then should travel up at a constant rate, that whenever I take any of these ordered pairs, I should get the same number. So 250 divided by 50, again, the y value over the x value, I get 5. If I do 75 divided by 15, I get 5. If I do 120 divided by 24, I get 5, just like I did over here with the image slash table that I had for the picture of the fences. So what equation models this relationship? So I could use y equals 5x, where x represents the length of the fence and the y represents the total cost of the purchasing that amount of fence. And notice that looks basically the same as whether I used y equals kx or y equals mx, where m represents the slope. Here we have a drone that's descending into a mining cave. Important piece of information there is that it's descending. And if I look at my graph, you can see that the line is traveling downward from left to right. And it's further reinforcing then these negatives here, that I'm in quadrant 4, and where I have my positive x values and my negative y values. So it says write an equation that describes the relationship in this graph. So basically, x is going to be the amount of time that passes, and y is going to be how deep the drone is below the surface. So in order to do that, I either need the constant proportionality or the slope. They are equivalent here. So if I look, I am going to need to pay attention to my scale. So I have two blocks on the x value it takes to make one. And when I move on the y direction, it takes two blocks in order to move down to negative 250. So that means halfway, or one block, would be negative 125. To make things easier, since I really don't want to move over just one block and then have that be a half in my denominator, if you look here, I am getting good dots on all the diagonals that I could use to find my slope. And so I'm simply going to move down two blocks and then the right two blocks. So that way, when I move to the right two blocks, that's just a change of one. When I move down two blocks, we see here that moving two blocks moves us 250, and it's down, so it's negative. So my slope, my delta y over delta x, is negative 250 over 1, which is just negative 250. I could also find the k value here because this is a proportional relationship. It's a straight line that passes through the origin. So when I take any of these ordered pairs, so for example, if I take this ordered pair, negative 1000 divided by 4, because that would be this point right here, which is 4 comma negative 1000. When I divide that, I get negative 250, as I would expect to get. So this is just further reinforcing that the k value and the slope are the same, with a big caveat, when it is a direct variation graph, when it passes through the origin. We will look at problems in the next two lessons, sections 8 and 9, where the lines do not pass through the origin, and so that relationship doesn't exist simply because they're no longer proportional relationships. You can't calculate a k value, but you can still calculate slope. So I still haven't written an equation. So I have already defined my variables over here, where y is distance and x is time. But it's the same as we've been doing with the y equals mx and the y equals kx equations, that they're basically the same in this situation since we're dealing with proportional relationships. So it's just going to be y equals negative 250x. And we can always check it. If I substitute in 1 for x, so at 1 second, negative 250 times 1 will be negative 250. So if I look at my graph, at 1, I am at negative 250. At 4, then I'm going to get 1,000, or negative 1,000. And if I look, that was the point that I get. So that equation does generate solutions on the graph for the line. Graphs are good, but notice this graph doesn't show after 4.5 seconds. Or if we knew that the drone was traveling further into the past, so 5 seconds before it reached ground level, how high was it? If it stayed at that sort of same rate, even though it's not necessarily realistic. The equation allows us to more numerically, algebraically, answer questions that are not in a table or on a graph, which is a value of an equation. This question is for you to do. So we have a graph here, and then asks you to find the slope and write the equation, and then asks us once again just to compare the y equals mx and the y equals kx equations. So go ahead and pause the video, try this problem for yourself, and then resume the video to see the answer. So when we looked at this, I found the slope both ways. For you, it doesn't really matter which way you found it, as long as you did one of them. So the first thing I did was I found the slope using the rise over the run in the table. So I picked two points, and I went up one block and then over one block, paying attention to my scale. So I went up 20, and then I went over one to the right. And so I ended up with a slope of 20. For the k value, I picked a point on the graph, and I can do that because it is a direct variation or a proportional relationship. It's a straight line that passes through the origin. So I picked 480 since it was the dot that was given on the graph specifically, and then did the y over the x, which is how ca the k value is calculated. 80 divided by 4 is 20, noticing they are the same. Then writing the equation will give you the same equation regardless of whether you were using K or M. And down below, it's just basically the two equations are the same. Here we have a recipe for trail mix that calls for 1 cup of raisins for every 2 cups of granola. Write an equation that describes the relationship between the raisins and the granola, and then graph that line. So the first thing whenever you're dealing with a word problem, whether it's an algebraic or graphically, you want to define your variables. And if we're working with a graph, then we want to make sure we have a label and maybe figure out what a scale might be for our scenario here. So we've got cups of raisins and we have cups of granola. So those are really my two variables. Now, depending on which way you define x or y is going to affect how your picture looks. In this situation, why don't we just say that x is going to be the cup of raisins and y is going to be the cup of granola? If you wanted to flip it around, you could. Your equation's going to look a little bit different, and so would your graph, but the relationship being expressed would still be the same. So since I've defined my variables, I'll go and put the labels on the graph. And then, as far as the scale's concerned, my rate here is 1 to 2, or my ratio is 1 to 2, or 2 to 1. So it doesn't seem that I'm really dealing with large numbers that wouldn't fit by doing a scale of 1. So I'm just going to do a scale of 1 on each axis. Now, it does ask me to find the slope. Now, if we think about this, this is a proportional relationship. If I have 0 cups of raisins, then I'm going to have 0 cups of granola. Now, the other way that I can do this, if I want to literally find the slope, like rise over 1 or delta y over delta x, is that I can make a little table and calculate some values for myself. So I know that 1 cup of raisins gives me 2 cups of granola. So 2 cups of raisins would give me twice the granola, so that would be 4. And if I have 4 cups of raisins, then I double that for the granola, and so that'd be 8. And then if I had 5 cups of raisins, then that would be 10 cups of granola. So if I do my delta y over delta x to calculate my slope, the change from 2 to 4 is a plus 2 change, so that's my delta y. And then from 1 to 2, that's a plus 1 change for my delta x. So my slope then, delta y over delta x, is 2 over 1, which is just 2. So if I wanted to write an equation, y equals mx, so y equals 2x, and notice that's the same as y equals kx because if I take each of these ordered pairs and divide it, the y by the x, 8 divided by 4 is 2, 10 divided by 5 is 2, 4 divided by 2 is 2, and 2 divided by 1 is 2. The last part of this then is we want to, looks like, graph it. And so if I know that at 0, I'm going to have 0 cups of raisins, 0 cups of granola. And then I could just plot some of those points. So I've got 1, 2. I've got 4, 8. And I've got 5, 10. Just give me a second to draw the line with my ruler. That's about the best I can do drawing it on a diagonal glass screen. So here we have our line. And we could use that line a little bit to estimate other points. So if I stay here at 1, 2, and I go up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1, and then on the other end here, up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1. And again, what I'm doing there is I'm just doing the slope. And notice how all of those dots match up on the line that I originally drawn. So we looked at a bunch of problems that were applications. Let's look at some basic stuff. So how do I write an equation from a graph? Well, in order to write an equation from a graph, we want to find where it crosses the y-axis, which we'll talk more about in the next two lessons, and I want to find the slope. So since the line crosses at the origin, then we're going to have an equation that looks like this, y equals mx, because there's no value being added or subtracted afterwards. So if we find the slope, here we have to be very careful with the scale. Our x-axis is counting by fives. Our y-axis is counting by two. And so if I do rise over run, I get up 2/5. So that gives me a slope of 2/5. So my delta y over delta x. So I get y equals 2/5 x. So that would be the equation for that one. Then for graphing the equation, we look to see whether there's anything being added or subtracted and to the x value. And if not, then I'm going to simply put a dot at the origin, because that's where I'm going to start then. So if x equals 0, then negative 3 times 0 is 0, so y equals 0. Basically, it's describing a proportional relationship. Then my slope tells me how to move to other points. So if my slope is negative 3, it will be helpful if we write it as a fraction. So we have rise over run. So this is telling me that if I rise negative 3, so remember that that means go downward since the rise is negative, and then run 1, positive 1, so that means go to the right. So if I go down 3 and 1 to the right, down 3 again, 1 to the right. I can't fit another one on there since I don't have enough room, but you can see that those dots are lining up. And I can test them too. If I substitute in negative 1 for x, then I get negative 3 for y. Negative 3 times 1 is negative 3. And 2 times negative 3 is negative 6, which is where this dot is. Now, you'll notice that this quadrant is rather empty, but it sort of looks like those dots would continue to go in that direction in order to form my straight line. So I can do slope in reverse in order to plot more points. So instead of doing negative 3/1, if I reverse the negative signs and do 3/-1, so then that's going to send me up 3 and then to the left 1, you can see that that is lining up with my other dots and has allowed me to put some other dots in the second quadrant. So give me a second to draw the line to connect the dots. And so anywhere that this line touches is a solution to the equation. Now, the one thing to keep in mind here is that we are estimating a little bit here because my line is not very straight. But if we had a very precise digital or computer-based graph, we could say that, whatever this value is right there, that would be a solution to the equation that was given, y equals negative 3x. This question is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video and answer the question, and then resume the video to see the answers. So we know that I can find the constant of a proportionality in this graph since the graph is a straight line that passes through the origin. So I picked a point and I just labeled it K, and then I'll get rid of that. So that point was 2 comma 60. And then remember that the constant proportionality is the y coordinate over the x coordinate, and 60 divided by 2 equals 30. The other part of the question was to actually find the slope, the rise over the run, which we've learned in this lesson that they are the same when you have a proportional relationship to start. And so I picked these upper two points. I did rise over run, so I started here and went up two blocks. And on this scale, a block is 15. If you look down at the bottom, it takes two blocks to get from 0 to 30. So I went up two blocks, so that's 30, and then over one block, which is just 1 minute. And then that gives me 30/1 for my rise or my run, which is equal to 30. And then that matches, which we would expect it would. So my equation is y equals 30x. So for example, if I do y equals 30 times 5, which equals 150, then this should be a point that's on my line, and if I look, it is. This question is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video and graph the equation y equals negative 1/2 x. Remember that that negative can either go with the numerator or the denominator value, however, it does not go with both when you're doing your rise over your run. So go ahead and pause the video and resume the video to see the final answer. So your equation should have looked like this. Notice that it has a downward trend from left to right, which is what I would expect with a negative slope. So again, I'm reinforcing that idea that a negative slope is a downward trend line, and that can help be a quick check to make sure that you've graphed things correctly. I started at the origin because this takes the form of a proportional relationship, y equals kx, and there is no number being added or subtracted to the x value. And so it starts at the origin. Then for my rise or my run, I mentioned that the negative only goes with either the numerator or the denominator, not both. I chose to put it in the numerator because it's more intuitive for rising to be up and down as opposed to running being the left and right when we're talking about the positives and the negatives. So I went down one and to the right two, and you can see that I did that here. And then I went in reverse. So you can go in reverse. So up two and then to the left one. And you can see I did that in order to plot a few more points in order to make the best line that I could. So in this lesson, we drew a relationship between y equals mx and y equals kx. And they are the same equation as long as you have a proportional relationship to start. Starting in the next lesson, we'll be looking at problems that look like this, where there is something being added or subtracted to the x term, and therefore it is not a proportional relationship or a direct variation. And we'll learn more about what that means in the next chapter. This completes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.